Welcome and good evening to the February 23rd, 2016 City of Shakopee City Council. Item number one, if we could call the roll.
Councilmember Whiting.
Here.
Councilmember Luce.
Here.
Mayor Mars.
Here.
Councilmember Mokel.
Here.
Councilmember Lehman.
Here.
Thank you very much. If we could go to item number two, stand for the pledge.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Moving to item number three, approval of the agenda. Councilor Mokel.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda.
I'll second.
I have a motion by Mokel, a second by Councilor Luce for approval of the agenda. Discussion. All in favor, say aye.
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 Those opposed, motion carries. Thank you very much. Item number four, recognition of any involved citizens to speak in front of the City Council on an item not on the agenda. If you'd like to come forward, please state your name and address for the record and welcome. On items not in front of the on the agenda tonight. Seeing none, we will move forward then to item number 5A, workshop on multi-family housing discussion. And Mr. Noble will present, or Kyle?
Kyle.
Kyle, kick us off.
No problem. Okay, thank you, Mayor Mars, members of the City Council. Last week at the City Council meeting, we had a chance to discuss the R4 zoning district and multiple family housing for the large amount of the city outside of the downtown. The purpose of tonight's workshop is to speak about the downtown area. So we'll move forward with the presentation. First off, why would we want to have more housing near the downtown? Look at a way to provide additional residents of all ages to support and expand downtown and 101 businesses. Right now, the majority of our housing units that are high density housing is senior housing. There are some smaller apartment buildings that are in the downtown and First Avenue area, but there has not been any recent construction of market rate standard apartments. So lately it's been the CDA projects have been the majority of the high density housing in the downtown. Another reason to have housing in the near the downtown area is to take advantage of the riverfront. Surrounding cities, including Burnsville and Savage, have all industrial property on their riverfront. Shakopee does not. So that's something that's near our downtown, and it's an opportunity that the city could look at. There's a close proximity to existing parks and trails. The city has put a large investment in Huber Park, as well as the surrounding area. So it's would be natural for that to be something that could be looked at as an asset to development in the area. Some of the sites are on the north side of 101. I know that's been a concern, having pedestrians crossing 101. Some of the sites that were prepared in the packet are on the north side of 101. Another reason would be utilization of struggling or vacant commercial sites. Some of the sites that were included in the packet, which we'll be going over later, are currently vacant or for sale. So there it's an opportunity. The regulations with the R4 text amendment have been adjusted, so some of these sites could, or the R4D regulations took some of them into account when I crafted the regulations. And last, one of the last reasons would be to take advantage of existing infrastructure and investment. Existing streets are already there. There's already sewer capacity. There's a water main already installed. Looking at other sites around the community, that's infrastructure that would need to be installed. A lot of this is already here and available to the sites or within close proximity. And last on this slide is convenient location for employees and employers. Scott County, Rahr Malting School District, the City of Shakopee, and Valley Green. The County Road 101 corridor is a is an easy access to the industrial park and be a short commute. And also with the opening of the 101 bridge, it's now an even easier way to get across the river to Eden Prairie and other employment centers. Now, we've seen the table at the last few meetings, and it's got can get a bit busy, but what are the main differences between the R4 zoning district and base R4 and the R4D? In the R4D, there's a smaller minimum lot size of 20,000 square feet, which is just shy of a half acre. In the R4T for transit and the base R4, the minimum lot size is 1 acre. Those sites that contemplate development of greenfield sites, so the lots can be created for the type of development that a developer would be looking for. Here we're dealing with all existing lots and or assembly of multiple lots, and typically the greatest depth that we see would be 142 feet because there are alleys in the downtown area. So unless an alley is vacated, the 142 feet is the width, and the maximum width that we would see for a whole block is 300 feet. Because of the smaller sites, there's reduced setbacks. It's one half of the building height, or 15 feet, whichever is less, to all the lot lines in the R4D versus 50 feet in the front, 40 feet in the rear. And the side setback for base R4 and R4T is one half the building height, or 15 feet, whichever is less. There's increased maximum impervious surface percentage, which would be hard surface, buildings, parking areas, sidewalks, any storm pond installations that are done. In the downtown area, we're dealing with smaller sites. So there's, when crafting the regulations, I matched the B1 highway business regulation of 75%, which is a current regulation. The 101 corridor is zoned B1, and this would match the regulation for impervious surface. And there's also an increased density allowance. The maximum density is 36 units per acre, with the opportunity with bonuses to go up to 40 units per acre. And there's also a reduced parking requirement of 1.75 spaces per unit versus 2.25 for base R4 and 2.0 for R4T. Now, other sites that we've looked at around the community have access by collector streets or other streets where parking is not permitted. So there's a greater need for other sites to have on-site parking versus in the downtown area where parking is permitted on the street. So we would anticipate that the parking for the units would be off-street parking, and parking for guests could be on the street. So it's still 1.75 spaces per unit, and then there is a bonus for being a slight reduction, which is available in all the other R4 subcategories, of 0.1 spaces per unit if it's within a proximity to a transit line. So this is the table that we've looked at a few times, and I just went over the differences between the R4D area or an R4D site. Again, there have not been any R4D sites that have been created. This is strictly regulations that would be in place if a property were to be rezoned to R4D. Existing sites in the downtown and riverfront area, if they are mixed use in the B3 or B1 zone, that's something that would be allowed already to be developed as multiple family residential. To take advantage of these different regulations for R4D, that would require a rezoning, but as it is today, if there was a commercial component, sites could be developed with high density residential in the downtown area. This is the map. R4D has a defined area of sites that could qualify for those special regulations. If a site is outside of this area as it stands today, they would be subject to the base R4 regulations, which would mean the smaller or the greater lot sizes, the larger setbacks, and lower densities. So the purple line that is shown on the map encompasses the downtown area, and the boundary on the south side is Third Avenue. And so sites on the north side of Third Avenue would qualify potentially for the R4D regulations. Now, the reason for that was to keep potential sites within close proximity to the downtown and the 101 district, and to not have a site that's off of 10th Avenue or completely surrounded by single-family residential development develop as a higher density project. Yes, Councilor Whiting.
Is it safe to say that the green areas along the riverfront are not buildable?
Mayor Mars, Councilor Whiting, that is safe. That is safe to say. There, the area here is floodplain. Areas here are below the bluff area, or they're owned by the DNR or the Fish and Wildlife Service. So areas in the green are generally would be off limits for development.
Thank you.
And they're zoned agricultural preservation. That's the reason for the color. This is the zoning map, but I use the zoning map to show the
sure.
to show the R4D area. Well, that's a copy of the slide. I apologize. Now, when looking at the R4 zoning district and why would we want to have development in the downtown area, we'd look at what are some of the strengths of the area for the downtown. We've got already existing infrastructure, parks, trails, and a current commercial destination. And there's been significant public investment recently. There's a lot of amenities in the downtown area. There's Huber Park. The Holmes Street Tunnel was just painted as a mural. There's been a lot of things going on. And downtown is gradually becoming more and more of a place that people want to be. Some of the weaknesses to downtown residential development would be railroad noise, site-specific constraints, and the assembly of parcels. Since we're dealing with smaller sites, in order to make a project go and be feasible and meet a minimum lot size, require some assembly, which could take additional investment. And then there could be from previous development over the past 150 years, there could be some contamination or structures that would need to be removed in order to develop the site. So there's different expenses versus greenfield development of high density residential housing. Some of the opportunities, there's riverfront views, development in a real downtown. A lot of communities are working on building a downtown. Burnsville is one, Ramsey is another. They've spent a lot of money trying to develop a downtown. Shakopee already has a downtown, and we've got some properties that may be prime for residential development. Some of the threats to multiple family residential development in the downtown would be singular uses purchasing key parcels for assembly. If there's three parcels that need to be acquired in order to make a project go, and if one of those parcels is purchased or a different use is done before a developer has a chance, that's something that could be a threat to a project. Some of the possible sites that were listed in the report, if there's any specific sites, I've got the aerial photos in the slide. One that was not included in the report was the City Hall site, and it's zoned B3. It's about, I believe it's 8/10 of an acre. So that's another site that was not included, but that was mentioned to me as a possibility. I don't know. There's certainly been council discussion recently on having City Hall go to the campus on Gorman Street, but that could be one additional parcel that would be an opportunity. Now, we can certainly discuss all of these parcels and see some of them may not be feasible, but it is just a list at this time. Now, I've listed the status of the property, the size of the property, and also the zoning. Most of the sites are zoned B1, which is highway business, and a couple sites are zoned B3, which is central business district. The difference between the B3 zone and the B1, the major difference is there's no off-street parking requirements in the B3 zone, and there are 0-foot setbacks. So a developer could look at whether they would want to develop under the B3 guidelines or potentially our zone to R4, and then be subject to the R4D requirements. So first we've got the Second Avenue sites. Both of these are on the north side of the railroad tracks. One of them is vacant, and the other has a warehouse building and a house on it. The site to the west is 1 acre. The site to the east is 3/4 acre. They are both zoned B1. They would be potentials for development. They're some of the largest parcels in the downtown area. The property to the east is actually being marketed and has been for several years. Yes, Councilor Luce.
On the eastern parcel there, the cutout there, who owns that piece between the street and the lot? I know the railroad used to run through there. Is that still held by the railroad?
Councilor, or Mayor Mars, Councilor Luce, I believe that is right of way. But I've checked county land records, and there's definite, that is not, is something that's incorrect. That is, that parcel is less than 1 acre. If you look, it would be identical to the parcel to the west, but there's a 1/4 acre of either right of way or abandoned railroad that would be.
Yeah, the railroad used to be there.
So whether it was a spur line or.
Yep.
So right. Who's the owner of record there?
I have objected. That'd be something that we'd have to look at. It may have been turned over to the city as right of way when it was abandoned.
Certainly, if it's city right of way, it could go through a vacation process.
Vacated.
Square that.
Right.
Out.
Square it up.
It was a siding at one time.
Right.
Okay.
So, some of the weaknesses of these sites would be directly adjacent to the railroad. When the city went through the 101 corridor study, we invited some developers in, and that was one of the concerns that major developers had, was the noise from the railroad, and that's obviously been a topic that the council has discussed with the quiet zone. But that could be, it may not be a barrier for some of the commercial development, but commercial development looks for visibility, and these sites aren't as visible from County Road 101. So maybe they would be attractive for residential development, but there's obviously the concern of the railroad.
We have a height restriction in the downtown area?
Yes, there's in the B1 zoning district, the maximum height is 35 feet. In the R4 zone, it is 45 feet.
So part of this exercise that we've gone through is try to actually think about some size, scale, and scope. They take the property with the building on it. That's 1 acre, you said?
Yes.
And if this was under our current regs, it could go to 40, I think, right? But would they be able to get 40 in 35 feet?
In 35 feet, that would be a significant challenge with getting parking there. I've got some drawings that we'll be discussing that kind of go over questions on that.
Okay, I'll wait then. Kent, did you have a question?
Just for the audience, Kyle, where is this in relation to downtown? I mean, I know what it is, but just explain where it is.
Sure. I apologize. This is where the cursor is running. This is County Road 101,
yep,
or First Avenue.
Yeah.
And this is Main Street right here.
No, that's Minnesota. No, Market.
This is Market right here, and this is Main.
So if you go off to the right, if your cursor keeps going off to the right, you're going to run into downtown. Am I right?
It would be to the left.
All right.
Yep. So So this is Fillmore Street.
Right up there's a Holiday.
Holiday is on the left.
Holiday is on the left. This is Riverside Liquor, Canterbury Car Wash.
Thank you. I got it.
There we go.
Are there any other questions on this specific site or these group of sites?
That building used to be the brewery.
No, it was a distribution center.
Distribution.
The kegs were there. It was a brewery to me. And then it turned into the salad plant.
We're gonna come back and talk about the scale and scope and like you mentioned.
Yes, certainly, but no, just getting going over the individual sites. If there's any questions, we can certainly see if counselors or members of the planning commission see these as potential sites or viable sites. We could have that as a discussion right now as we look at the sites individually.
Well, I think they, you know, I'm gonna say they look good, except for if I'm a developer, my most major concern here is a railroad. But you could try to overcome that with insulation or triple thick walls and windows.
My thought was garage on that bottom floor too. Mm-hmm. And then you're actually starting on the second floor with the...
I mean, we have a whole group of residents that live right across the, you know, right mm-hmm. next to the railroad.
These two roads here don't have any crossings, so you're not going to get the horn blast there. You get it back before this one.
On Market.
They but wake you up before they come by.
You don't hear it. Once you've lived there a couple weeks, you don't hear it.
Well, Kyle, what happens if somebody comes in and takes a look at one of those lots and say, I want to build, but I want to go up high? I mean, it'd be a zoning change, and what about, it's 35 feet. You said 35 feet is the height restriction.
Under the current B1 zoning regulations, right. That's correct. So to rezone to R4, the maximum goes up one additional story to 45 feet.
Right.
If a developer would like to have an additional floor or additional ceiling height in each of the floors, as sand companies did, mm-hmm. Would like to have, they would seek a conditional use permit for an overheight structure, and that would be reviewed by the Board of Adjustment and Appeals, and depending on their project, it may get reviewed by the City Council as well.
And just to give an idea here, some of the higher buildings in town, the old Sports Stop, I think of, how tall is that?
Sports Stop is three stories. The majority of the buildings in the downtown are two. But Sports Stop is one of the three-level buildings. River City Center is as well. Sports Stop is probably about 33 feet, but they've got some rooftop equipment right on there that makes it a bit taller. Northbridge Court is about 50 feet in height. The Henderson was approved at around that height as well. And 200 Levy Drive is six stories. So that would be outside of RAR, that would be the tallest structure in the downtown area. Any other discussion on these sites? So another site, this is 981 Bluff Avenue East. Mr. Robbins may be familiar with this from some conditional use permit reviews recently. So the site in the front should look a lot better right now. Currently it's being marketed and it's two parcels. It's...
Which one, are we talking about this one in front?
One in yellow.
In yellow. The parcels that are of discussion are highlighted in yellow.
Kyle, what's it being used for now?
It's a body shop at this point, or vehicle repair, and the property is for sale. It's been a vehicle repair facility for several years. There's also the total site acreage is just shy of a half acre. It is actually just shy of the minimum lot size. It's about 800 square feet short of the 20,000 square foot minimum lot size.
Combined. Wow.
So put it up there as a potential site, even because it is close in that it's currently for sale. It's also directly adjacent to the state trail and the river. Since in the almost 11 years that I've been here, this site's been an enforcement issue, and as some folks are aware, the police are aware as well, and we've worked with them on that.
It looks a lot better now than that picture.
Yes.
Kyle, size and scope here, the I believe the last apartment building built in Shakopee there, Kitty Corner.
National Handicap Housing.
Good looking building. What type of density do they have? Are they B1 or B3 with no commercial? So are they at about, I guess I don't know.
Their site is one acre. There was a text amendment that was done for to have housing for handicapped individuals be a conditional use in the B1 zone. That was built in about 2005 or 2006. The total number of units there is 24, and the site is about an acre, so it's 24 units per acre.
It's about right where our base R4 is then, right?
That's correct, and I believe they only have surface parking.
Yeah.
I don't believe there is underground parking in this building, but
it's 1 acre, and they're meeting the setbacks plus providing some parking.
Correct. Right. They just have the surface parking, and also the setbacks in the B1 zone are greater than the R4D. They're not much different, but the R4D regulations would allow for a little more flexibility.
We did have some variation on that project. I just can't remember what it was. If it was a roof height or a building close to a lot line or something. I just can't remember what it was.
I believe the house next, is that a duplex? Is there some?
I believe there may be four units
four
there.
Four units? Okay.
In the building that's just to the east of the body shop site.
1150 there. Can you say that might be a fourplex?
I believe that is a fourplex.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
There are some unique businesses down there.
This is when we started talking about this. My idea was always that if we could get close to the river and be environmentally sound, that was a really good place for housing, and that really you could do market rate very easily. The only thing about it was that I always envisioned it going up higher than 40, 35 feet.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what council members or people would think of that, because we don't have a lot of that. But when I think of a site like this, I think of
height.
I think
and
of
views.
Going,
yeah.
And view.
Yeah, yeah.
If I'm on the 15th floor of a building like this, all of a sudden, look what I'm looking at.
Yep.
Right.
And so I'm willing to pay for that.
Yep.
Hmm. And that's, I know that we haven't really spent a lot of time talking about height, and that's what I asked earlier about just some, the heights of some other buildings, and the ordinance of what that calls for are 35, which is our standard house height, or a little higher in the B3. But how does that fit into our community? Mike?
If they did put a building with a footprint the same, about the size of the lot, could they buy the parcel on the opposite side and use that for parking? Would that be allowed?
Mayor Mars, Councilor Luce, yes, that would be allowed. There's a mechanism in the code for having off-site parking, and they would just get an off-site parking. It's reviewed by the board, and it needs to be within 350 feet, in order to have it qualify. But there is a mechanism for that.
But if you remove the parking from the yellow area of the lot, you could put a much bigger building there and make it more feasible.
Certainly you could.
1 acre combined it, you still have the setbacks, and then really the only other way would be to go up.
Yeah, but if you look at the one in Kitty Corner,
right,
you got all that parking around it. You can move that parking over here,
right,
you can expand that building.
Right. Jay?
Just a curiosity, Kyle, do you have any explanation for the little lots on the riverside?
Mayor Mars, Councilor Whiting, I am not sure what those additional lots are. Each of those small lots are owned by the adjacent property owner,
okay.
But I'm not sure how they exactly came into existence. A lot of those structures were built in the late 1800s, The lots were created at that time as well.
That might have been when the plat was disappeared and came back with more lots.
1151 up there was moved in, so was 1152 and 1150. All three of those were moved in.
But that lot line goes right through middle of Cher's house, so.
All right, so they are two separate lots. They never did a administrative combination. But certainly if that were to get cleaned up, one of the first things you would do is consolidate, right, administratively.
Yeah, the original lots in this area were created in, I believe, 1854 as part of the plat of East Shakopee. So there's a lot of things that have happened since then.
They did.
Well, because I was even looking, Mayor.
No.
But I was even looking at, it looks almost like a handle there next to where the yellow and the red come together.
Like the trail or something.
Yep.
Well, the trail is right back there.
But above 1150 and 11, you see where I'm talking about?
It's that. She's talking about that.
Oh, that piece.
See it over here, too.
It might have been an access or something at some point.
It could be a portion. My guess is it's a portion of a vacated alley.
Okay. Let's just go around here. And final thoughts on this site, Kathy?
I agree with Kent. When I look at these properties here, I think of height. I think of people wanting to look, you know, over and above the bluff views. And that's the thing that, for me, is if we did it in this area, I'd really want to look at that height piece of it and make sure that was available to the developer.
You know, I'll just stand on what I said. I think it's a nice site, a good site, and if it was cleared, I would look very hard at conditional use to go above, quite a bit of above 35 feet.
One comment on that, from speaking with developers, as you get taller in height, the construction type changes and the regulations change, and it becomes a lot more expensive. So there's different construction types, and that's where SAND had looked at having a taller building for the northernmost building. But with the changes in construction type, you can use wood for construction up to four levels. Above that, you have to go to...
switch it out to concrete.
Yes,
steel.
Concrete and steel, which adds to the expense. That'd be something to think about, definitely, where some of these properties may not have the value that warrants that type of construction, at least not at this point.
So. But anything over a four-story building down there would look a little out of place.
Not if you have a bunch of them. Somebody will start it.
Matt?
Well, I think you put 40 people next door to a noisy metal shop, you're going to have a lot of complaints. I think if you go up and it expands both directions, you're blocking the riverfront from the rest of the population. Kind of walling it up, walling it off and having it as a personal benefit for just those living on the riverfront. That's my comments for now.
Mark, do you have any comment on what we're talking about, just in general?
I'll just add two things. You know, I've been here 15 years. I've always thought of the riverfront as a lost opportunity for some nice development. And I also concur with Matt, just the view corridor. If we get too high, what happens behind? So you see some communities, well, closer to the amenity might be lower, and then they're going to start to stack it as it gets further back, but not sure how you would do that. I think it would involve some more discussion.
Okay.
I think it'd be a good spot for our R4D program. I'd have to take a look at some of the heights, you know, plan, but possible, you know, on a conditional use, but I think that's a good site to clean up that area and put some development in there.
And as a reference, the current regulations would allow for one additional floor above what the handicap housing building is that's in this picture. Anything beyond that would require a conditional use permit.
I thought you said 35 feet.
In the B1, it is 35. If a property rezones to R4, then the maximum height is 45.
Oh,
it switches.
And then.
So it could be high, it could be really, to me, four stories high, right?
Well, it could be five with a conditional use permit. Or six.
Oh, yeah.
Or ten.
I'm just trying to bring some scale, so if this site, I'm sorry, Mike?
No, go ahead, finish your thought.
It's a half acre, so it's really kind of similar to the adjacent apartment building, so, you know, it says you can go up to 40, but it's only a half acre, so I'm only looking at, you know, 20 to 24 units, and yeah, it could be another floor, but it's not gonna be to me, a hulking huge building, I mean.
No, you're gonna have more than one unit per floor.
Right.
Okay.
All right. Let's move forward.
Next site is, this is First Avenue here, First Avenue West, and this is Atwood Street. This is the vacant gas station. And this is the city-owned gas station site here. The sites are highlighted in yellow. These two sites on the south side of the alley are zoned B3. We've received interest from folks about the southern parcel. The northern parcel, or the gas station, is vacant at this point. A conditional use permit was issued, but at this time the property owner hasn't taken advantage of the conditional use permit for that site. And this would be a case of looking at assembly or of two sites or three sites. Now, they're currently zoned B3, so the regulations are the least restrictive regarding setbacks, which for these sites would be great because they're in a regular shape.
Jay?
You said the gas station has a conditional use permit it hasn't taken advantage of. What is that for?
Mark was the project manager.
It was vehicle repair and sales of new vehicles.
And that has a clock ticking on it?
Yes.
Okay. I have a question. How big is lot 13, the gas station?
Gas station site is two lots. So it is about 17,000 square feet. So it'd be about 4/10 of an acre.
Jay?
I may add that the house, the property identification number looks like 11310,
yeah.
Immediately to the west there. I believe, you know, that's not occupied, it's owned, but it could be potentially sold. It's
somebody's cleaning it up right now.
Are they? Well, that's going to take a lot of work.
Trees down.
A lot of work. But maybe
so
that yellow line could be extended, I'm saying.
The gas station is less than a half acre, correct?
Correct. And the total of the two sites to the south is around a half acre. Now, obviously, if the gas station were to be included, there's removal of the building, tanks, there's significant expense involved.
And maybe it's an environmental concern.
Certainly. But these are in close proximity to the downtown. They're just to the west.
So you're saying if I could buy the gas station, the other parcel to the south, vacate the alley, combine them, I'd have about an acre, right?
Correct. You'd have just shy of an acre, and you wouldn't necessarily, depending on your project, you wouldn't necessarily have to vacate the alley either.
No, right. Then in proportion, how big is the city-owned property?
City-owned property is an additional 15 feet in width than the gas station that's on the west side of the street. So this is the city site here.
Yep.
The lots, this site is 120 by 142. The city site is 135 by 142.
Jay?
Do you believe that the city-owned property is too small for R4, and that's why you haven't drawn a yellow line? Are we getting to that property, or?
Mayor Mars, Councilor Whiting, that's gonna be later. That's one of the later sites. On its own, it would be too small. As a site, it wouldn't meet the minimum lot size requirements.
Okay.
So when we're looking then truly at this slide in particular, and maybe kind of the other one, that the site assembly is a required piece to get any economies of scale or actually something you can work with.
For a fair amount of the sites, yes.
Thank you.
Next site would be the city-owned sites on County Road 101. This is First Avenue in the foreground, and this is the intersection of Marshall Road. This is Perkins. This is the Travel Lodge, and that's Valley Haven Mobile Home Park and Apple Ford. The total area of these sites is about 3 acres. There are some drainage and utility easements on the east side of the site. But these sites have been sitting vacant and were marketed for several years. And Mr. Steve, who is the former, ended up donating these to the city. So the city could look at potential development, whether commercial, residential. This would be the largest site in the near the downtown area. Potentially look at multiple uses as
a possibility. Can we pay something for them site? We paid for them, something for them sites. We paid the taxes due on
Back taxes, yeah.
Jay?
You know, when I first thought of the downtown, and I know we use this as a bike trail and we wouldn't do anything until we had that new bridge, I would think, but I thought of this site first as a great spot for R4D.
What did you say this is zone, B1?
It is zone B1. All three parcels are zone B1.
What's the acreage?
Yeah.
It's about 3 acres.
Three. Kyle, is there any environmental concerns on this that you know of?
Not that I'm aware of.
So you could look at, just quick math here, over 100 units on this property? Is that correct?
Correct.
Yeah.
Jay?
We have that lift station there. Do we know of any issues that might force us to have to change the development on that property with some of the force mains and things in there, a lift station, or?
Mayor Mars, Councilor Whiting, I'm not aware of any, but I'd want to speak with the Public Works Director about that.
Sure.
There are easements on the east side of the site that are, I believe, are either 25 or 30 feet wide that are directly on the east side that would limit development. Okay. And again, when looking at whether it be 100 units, that's only if a developer were to take advantage of the
full density. Do you know the exact location of that lift station?
Lift station.
Yes,
right there.
Lift station's right over here.
How about the interceptor? Draw a line to the east from that building there. Yep, it runs in there somewhere.
I think there's an easement at least this width across the north part of that lot, but
is that where the where the line runs?
I think there's some more utilities in that area.
Well, let's talk about these sites. We all lived in our community for various lengths of time. This was talked about a long time ago. 20, 25 years ago even. I was talking about this is kind of the gate into the gateway of our town. You have Memorial Park and Dangerfields and I'm kind of going, wow, why hasn't this developed to this point now? B1, highway business seems to fit in with the surrounding roughly. Some housing there to the east, but just go around. Mike, anything that sticks out in your mind why this hasn't been developed over a lot?
Puzzled me for a long time.
Okay.
We put snow on it, maybe they don't want to move it.
Yeah, that's what they do, put snow on it.
Mark, you've had people come and ask,
yeah,
but nothing.
We get inquiries, but usually share that there are some easements, but those are more in the setback area, so it's not like that really limits the site.
Right, nothing right across the middle of it.
And even this could be another nice access into the site too. So there's some nice possibilities, but just nothing is ever really
Frontage, okay.
Oh.
Matt?
I would guess they're looking for highway access and it's too close to the intersection and they don't want to go all the way around the block.
Probably, yeah.
That'd be my guess.
Yeah, but isn't there a curb cut there already?
I think there is.
Well, they'd let you continue to have it.
County's not going to let you have access. They're going to run you around the block.
Huh?
They're going to run you back around.
Yeah.
Right. And, you know, this comes up a lot. So if the county owns the road, you may have an unplatted or even platted undeveloped lot that appears like you have a curb cut. And then when you go to develop it, and the county goes, oh, no, no. And it's got to be a quarter mile. I know many places in our community where we've tried to fight that, and it.
I think the interceptor goes somewhere crosswise on this property too.
I think it does too.
I think it
goes north and south right along the housing development there.
Actually, I know it goes underneath the mill pond.
I can pull that up.
Yeah, let's do that.
Yeah.
I'd be curious to know where that is. I thought it chopped off a corner of this property.
So would that have to be moved?
Okay.
You ain't moving that.
It's snowing on.
Put the parking lot over it.
Yeah, maybe that. Yeah.
Thanks, Kathy. Maybe I missed a Kathy sighting thing about that site.
That
what
site?
Want?
Yeah, did Kathy,
Kathy
comment on that site?
Well, I would think it's also in and out. I think it's a lot of mixed use around it that could keep people from looking at that site. I think it's marketability is how we market the site. I think that plays a lot into it. I could see it as a mixed use where maybe you have some retail and then you have the housing on top. I mean, that's something that could happen here.
No, I just want to bring up the access point because I know that, you know, this week, Warner Stallion's opening, Goodwill's down there. That's kind of an industrial road that not a lot of folks travel down, but now some businesses are going down there. They may see it from the freeway and then go, how do I get there? I mean, that's kind of the, but I actually think of like McDonald's off of Canterbury Road that you kind of got to go turn on it and go past it and then come back. I think in today's day and era, if you have something where I'm going to go, a destination, whether it's a retail or commercial or housing, I mean, I'm going to learn how to get there and figure it out. But that's kind of just my comment on that. I don't think it's a big barrier as it used to be.
Mayor, I sort of agree with Kathy. I think the reason maybe that this hasn't been involved is because of what's around it right now, and that, you know, we haven't been aggressive and we haven't said, look, this is available. If you look what's around there right now, a developer might say, well, this isn't a place for it. And, you know, depending on how we sort of present this, they might reconsider that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you put something on this, some of the surrounding uses might change.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. We were going around the table here.
Where's that interceptor at?
It's the heavy red line here.
So it's under the road.
Yeah, it's under the driveway.
Other comments on this property? We were kind of thinking about why it hasn't developed, Jay.
Well, just the thought, if they couldn't get access, then the B1, the businesses probably wouldn't want to go there unless you could pull right into their driveway. That might be what has been restricting it. Any thoughts on that, Mark? Has that come up? Or?
No, I'm just kind of looking at this. Now, a lot of these are existing cuts on the road, and they got the center turn lane. Granted, we start to get a little tight to that intersection, you want to be concerned, but I just had my notes I was going to follow up with Public Works or County about access for that site.
But if it was an apartment, I think no tenant would have an issue going around the block to get to the apartment.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. That's the destination you're going to go.
Mm-hmm.
Other comments?
How much is it for sale for?
Well, we haven't decided that, have we? It's a city owned.
So we got a for sale sign on it?
No, we never did that.
No.
Well, no wonder why there's no inquiries.
That's what I was thinking. Market
city,
it.
The city owns us, but I thought I'd seen a sign where we had a listing with an agent at one time. Maybe I'm wrong.
Maybe before we owned it.
One of those big wood signs that wasn't in the ground. It was a.
I had to ask a basic question, you know?
It's a good question.
And that's a good question, Counselor, because essentially what we really need to do is to do an analysis of all of our property, determine whether the city has a use for it. If we do, okay. But if not, market it.
We can dump snow somewhere else.
That's something that, you know, in the next 6 months or so, we really need to do.
Raise some revenue. Everybody likes that.
Do we have any use for this other than dumping snow?
Well, you don't know if you got any future use for the sewer either, so that's something to think about.
You essentially have to take a hard look at it.
Future use of the city?
The lift station replacement in the future.
Always dump money into that.
Raise revenue and increase tax base.
Well, but, you know, if you put, Councilmember Lehman, this point, if you put this for sale under certain circumstances and said, all right, we're going to sell it, and we'll look at multifamily. You know, when you think about the site, the intersection of 101 and Marshall, the gateway to Shakopee, I mean, I would think that we might have some people that come in, we'll take a shot at it, that, you know.
I don't know if I would limit yourself to that. I'd go a lot broader than that. Yes, for sale.
Multifamily.
Here's a lot of the uses you could use it for.
Yeah.
Right now, you've got a underlying zoning of a, what is it, B1 or B3?
B1.
You've got an overlay over top of it of a mixed use, which is, allows commercial and high density. Or you could put just business there. You've got a lot of options there.
Yeah.
And it's a lot easier to market it with a bunch of different options than it is to say, here's what we want you to put there.
Kathy?
And that's what I was saying. It's more of a multi-use, and I think that's, it's just giving people ideas of not only the things around it, not keeping it from being something, but encouraging it to be more. And that's why I thought, you know, if you did that multi-use where maybe you have some retail in there, maybe you have, and housing as well, I think that brings it all together.
But I think the market needs to make that decision, not us.
No, but.
But we have to say we're open to it.
Right.
Sorry.
We already did by having our overlay on a B1 zoning for mixed
use. No, but promote it.
Right. Well, that's currently.
You know, hey, I got it for sale, but it's, I got the paperwork in the back closet there. I don't tell anybody about it.
That's allowable today.
Yeah. B1 zone is one of our most flexible zoning districts.
Right. No, I.
And it has the mixed use overlay, which is, makes it even broader yet.
Okay. Well, let's, move forward.
Okay.
Good discussion on that.
These sites are on First Avenue West. This is near RAR's BSG warehouse, which is this area here. Sites that are in the area, none of them are highlighted because there's any number of possibilities here. There's total rental. This is a vacant lot. Mm-hmm. Total rental, they have the building, and then there's also the parking area as well. And then this parking area is owned by Mark Hauser along with the building. RAR Malting owns this parcel here, but I believe the easternmost portion of the property is not going to be used. So there's a number of different possibilities in this area. This is Apgar Street right here, and this is Scott Street.
And even that parcel on the east side of Scott Street.
Yes, that's going to be listed. I'm going to discuss that on another slide.
Sorry.
So this is owned by the city here, but that's on another slide.
Kyle, how far to the right is there's public housing?
Right there, though.
Is it right on the right?
Right on that. You know, you keep on going down that.
Yeah, just
road.
A little bit to the east is 200
Levy
Drive.
One house, the street, and then.
All right. Yeah. All right. Good. Thanks.
So. These parcels are not for sale, right?
That's correct.
So, but one owner owns 0901 and 0910?
Yes, that's correct. And then the other owner
and
is.
Total
these.
Rental owns two?
Yep. And RAR owns the rest.
Right.
The city
owns. I think, though, that what is the. We have a pretty big now, brand new impact on 0930. just to the west there. I mean, that we have a huge warehouse building, right?
Mm-hmm.
Changes the look of that neighborhood a little bit.
Could you clarify then? Because where is that alley where the trucks are coming out? Is that coming out?
The alley would be right
here. Right here, okay.
Well, that moved a little farther north.
To the north.
And so just talk about lot size here, the combination of total rentals lots.
Total rentals lots are be just shy of an acre.
And then
the others would be about the same size, that probably, I believe it's 8/10 of an acre.
So those two lots, 2 acres combined, and then the lot that RAR owns to the north, you know, that's at least another acre plus, right?
But is all of that lot buildable?
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't that fall off into the floodplain?
It does fall off on the west.
Quarry back there.
But on the east, there would be some buildable area.
And you'd also have to take into consideration that alley being with RAR's traffic. That's
mm-hmm.
That's correct.
It's good.
Yeah.
And quite a few trucks coming in and out.
So how do you decide if 940, the parking lot with the trucks in it, but right there, is going to, and the rental place next door, how do you decide if that's going to be an extension in the future of what's next to it as a light industrial?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think,
or
excuse me.
Kathy?
I think that's my point was, where is that alley coming out of? Because do you really want to put housing there, multifamily, when the county restricts the access to those roads? Because I don't think they want us want crossing of that 101. You know, so that was my point of where is that coming out? Because that was part of why they forced RAR down to the other street.
Well, and I'm saying that, you know, if you think 20 years from now, I would see 940, 900, and moving to the east, probably light industrial.
Mm-hmm.
That's
just to match the
yeah.
neighborhood?
That's kind of what I'm thinking. I mean, it could be R4, make your cutoff,
right.
But you're not allowing it to be industrial at that point.
Right.
So.
And this is B1 here?
Correct.
Okay.
Well, that's I-1 right there.
On the RAR site is zoned industry.
And a light industrial, right?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Was it light?
The brewery place is light industrial, isn't it? And then across the street is
I thought it was I-1.
Not on
the big industrial.
For some reason, I'm thinking those
I-2. Not on the north.
Oh.
Yeah.
But of all the sites so far, this is probably more complicated,
mm-hmm.
especially with the
access.
Brand new impact of RAR, the alleyway,
the
multiple
access.
Lots. This would present, and then the grade of the fall off on 0920, because you end up with a half a lot there, you know, big part of it that you can't use.
Well, and then our tree ordinance falls into that. They start clearing that, that's going to be expensive to put back.
Well, clear the trees so I can see the river.
It's the road back there. Road
that's
back
the
there.
That's the path. Bike path.
Yeah, there's the there's the state trail and then the maintenance trail for the
right.
sewer.
Go around the table. Mike, comments on this?
Very complicated.
Okay. Jay?
I mean, it could work. I'd rather see it in R4D than industrial, but somebody could make it happen, I'm sure.
Mark?
Parcel I'm looking at most, well, besides the city-owned piece, is what the potential for that RAR piece could be, whether that would be commercial or residential.
Which piece?
Okay. If they want to get rid of it.
Yeah,
whatever.
That piece. Yeah.
RAR, what are you going to say about this? I apologize.
No, that looking at that site as either residential or potentially commercial, but those along 101 with access concerns.
All right.
little bit more complicated.
I thought the 920 was zoned industrial, no.
It was part of that zoning, but I know there was some talk about that, but I think it ended up going zoning, but if they don't have any use for that, you can always look at a different zone in the future.
Matt?
I think trying to stuff a bunch of cars down an alley with a bunch of semis is a nightmare.
Huh? Cars and semis that don't go together?
Well, you're talking high-density housing with a bunch of cars using the same alley as a bunch of semis are using, because you're not going to get the access for redevelopment on the First Avenue. It's going to be a problem.
Oh, I agree.
I think this is a tough site because of what's around it and the potential of having more of, you know, industry around it. This is the site, of all the sites we've looked at, I think this one's the most problematic.
Okay. Kathy?
I agree. The access piece makes this really tough.
Cool. Okay. Thanks.
Next site would be the City and Olympic Pool site. This is the gas station that the city owns. The site is 142 feet by 135 feet. And then the site to the south is Olympic Pools. It's two parcels, and it is about 3/4 acre. And then with the city site, it would be just over an acre if the two were together. Now, there's a city-owned parking lot directly to the east, so that's something that could potentially be taken advantage of for guest parking or off-site parking. Again, that's purely a hypothetical. As far as I know, Olympic Pools is not being marketed, but the city site is for sale, and haven't heard any interest yet, but Sam has been contacting folks on that. This is one of the closest sites into our downtown area, but it is also right on the railroad tracks, and then this is Atwood Street right here running north-south.
Kyle, just for our viewers, what's the building on the right, upper right hand?
That is the Laurent Building. On the right, this is Wampach's right here. And then this is the
Eagle.
Title company. Yeah.
Okay.
And
yep.
The Eagles. Eagles is right here, and this is their volleyball courts.
Are we targeting the site south of the city lot because it's convenient for us, or how did we come to the conclusion of that lot?
It's proximity.
Is it for sale?
Not that I'm aware of.
All right. So unless the owner's got an interest in selling it.
Are you saying that all four of those lots are city parking lots?
The four lots here, yes, they're all
city lots.
They're all city owned, and it's a parking lot that's used by the Laurent Building, and then and then I believe some of the customers of the Eagles Club.
Who owns 1410 next to the Laurent Building?
I believe Laurent owns that.
Yeah. And what about the house 1420?
That's a separate owner.
Okay, is that active?
Yes.
Being used?
Yes.
Isn't that the H&R Block guy who owns that?
No, that vacant lot, they had the house fired. There used to be that.
The house I'm talking about.
Yeah. I'm not sure. Is that a B3?
Yes, all of these sites are zoned B3.
Some of these are expensive propositions because you got to buy them,
mm-hmm.
Then you got to demo them.
Well, my question is, who's buying them, for starters?
I don't know.
City.
Whoever wants to.
Kathy?
I think for me, I've always envisioned this as a mixed use as well. You know, maybe because of the rent building that sits on that northeast corner, is that this would be great for the office space and then maybe some housing on top of it. I think that's what I've always envisioned right here.
Do you think, I'm gonna go around the table here, if you think this is a great site, I'm gonna bring up height here because right across the street we kind of have a higher building.
Mm-hmm.
Laurent appears high, gives a perception of height.
Illusion.
Coal Rush Title Building is in the in this area as well.
Right, and that looks like a big building, even though it's not technically that high. It just gives a perception of being high, right?
Yeah, it's close to the street.
I kind of like this site. I think Councilmember Lehman said that, you know, if you look at the railroad tracks to the south, there's that concern. Part of how you get around that, or at least mitigate that, is to go up. You're still going to have sound, but it's not the same thing if you're in the air. So, and I do take what council members have said, that it's an expensive proposition, depending on who buys for assemblage.
Matt?
I think you mitigate the railroad track by putting your parking rear loaded.
Put the parking against a park up against the railroad track?
Yep.
I thought about that, right, when we were discussing this, and I went, you know, sound does travel, and then it bounces off the building. Maybe traffic to create the distance, but I'd want some trees there to absorb the sound. And I also agree with you, Kent, that the trains sound like this, and, you know, if you went up a little bit, you might not hear that as intense blare if you're right next to it, just because of the cone of the volume, even though, you know, when they blow the horn, I hear it where I live over by the community center. But I yeah. Mark, what are your thoughts on this site? Sites?
I like the city lot as some potential. Certainly zoned commercial now, but as Council Member Mokel said, I see some nice mixed use there. So I'm encouraged to see something happen at that site soon.
Jay?
Well, I think some developer could take this block and do something with it. You know, we do have bookend parcels that we could help add to that. So I see it as a potential, maybe not with all that height, but.
Bookend parcels, what do you
mean? We have the parking lot there and we own that lot there.
Okay. Mike?
I would think the only way this could work would be 14, 10, 20, and 30 go together with our city lot. The other two are going to be too expensive to purchase and do anything with.
What is 1420?
No, the Laurent building, as it's called, which is not owned by him anymore.
No.
And then the Olympic pool site. Those are going to be expensive sites to purchase and demo.
Right.
The 1420, that's just a house that, you know, that wouldn't be that big of a demolition problem. Our site is empty right now. It's ready to go.
No, I know, but I think we have our site's ready to go, but you wouldn't do that on something like this. You wouldn't do that one site alone. You would assemble.
That would be a commercial use only, under if it was just the
city.
Oh,
right, yes.
Without getting
singular
other properties.
Without getting other properties, it would be.
But if you take 14, 10, 20, and 30 and put them together, you got two of them that are pad ready.
And I think this has the typical issues of assembly, demolition, but it has very good proximity to the downtown. It is, you know, basically right across the street from a denser building. It turns out to be, you said 1 acre of the Olympic pools and the city owned site, but you didn't tell us how big the parking lots are. So this would be, to me, the second largest concept of assembly of properties that we've seen tonight. If you looked at the city-owned 1430, the Olympic pools, and then the parking lot.
Yeah, conceivably, you'd look at every site on the block except the Lorraine building.
Yeah. Mr. Mayor, you know, I don't know that we should be concerned other with the cost of assembling and demolition, other than the resources it takes, and we don't want in the cost. But if someone's willing to do that, if someone's willing to sell, I mean, we should be looking out and saying, this is what our vision is. And so I don't worry about the other stuff.
Mayor, I do think, though, that Kathy's, Councilmember Mokel's right. The when I look at this and I go, if I see height, I see commercial on the ground floor. I can't imagine multifamily housing here without commercial that's on the ground floor.
And again, I don't think you limit yourself. If somebody wants to come in and put a commercial something there, I'm good with it. If they want to come in and put commercial on the bottom and residential on top, that's fine. Mm-hmm. If they want to come in and do just residential, you know, mm-hmm. whatever. You know, why limit yourself when, you know, you might be sitting on something that's vacant for a long time because you've limited yourself. With that, I'll be back in about 2 minutes.
Right. I think, Kathy, when you bring up the mixed use, I agree with that, but if I'm going to do commercial down below and residential above, I still think that 1430 is still too small to get my bang for my buck.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm all in favor of the new concept where you have that, you know, Excelsior and Grand type thing with the, you know, and actually River City Center,
yeah.
you know, the retail down below. But I need a bigger site here. Matt, I think what Matt was saying, and he left the room, his deal is if a guy came forward that just wanted to do commercial on 1430, we would strongly consider it, and obviously, mm-hmm. you know, without any housing component to it. But that still wouldn't limit the concept that on the two parcels next to the railroad, it still could technically happen
mm-hmm.
with the city lots and the Olympic pools. But
and Mayor Mars, one thing when I mentioned earlier in the presentation, mentioned threats. If one of these parcels were to be purchased and developed as a singular use, that limits the opportunities for the rest of the
right.
site.
Mm-hmm.
If the Laurent parcel, the parcel next to the Laurent building were to be purchased, or the house, that changes things.
Right.
Then you're pretty much limited with commercial. And on this site, you're probably only going to see commercial on the only facing First Avenue. You're not going to see commercial facing Second Avenue.
Right.
It doesn't have the visibility. Then you also, with the commercial, some of the things that I would see as a potential challenge on this site that would have to be looked at very closely is where do the commercial customers park?
Mm-hmm.
Depending on the types of use, you could be looking at a heavy parking use for the commercial, and they want convenience and they want convenient parking. If the rest of the site's developed as residential, that makes a challenge, and it'd be a very important site plan to look at, that it works for both the commercial and the residential, because the commercial looks for convenience and they look for visibility, and being able to park there. Right now there's cuts on the street, that could, and it is in B3, so there is no requirement for off-street parking. If somebody were to take full advantage of that, they could develop the entire site with a building and not have any off-street parking. Now, not that the market supports that, they're probably going to want to have some parking for their commercial uses, but that's something, it's something to think about.
Mm-hmm. All right, good.
One last comment.
Yeah.
The city property there, if somebody came in tomorrow and bought it and wanted to put a business there, I'd tell them, welcome to Shakopee.
Welcome to Shakopee?
Absolutely. I mean, we're not going to not sell that property because we don't know what we want to do with it. Are we? Huh? I'm asking.
I do think it's our job to guide the development that comes into town. And I think when you start looking at downtown, the piece that you want to look at is that getting your tax per acre higher. I mean, you have that opportunity.
Well, you can do it now. Because it doesn't,
but I'm saying that we are the guiding, we are that guiding body, and we do need to guide what happens in this downtown.
Currently, it's zoned for what?
Zoned B3 commercial.
If somebody came in for it with a B3 proposal, would we sell that property tomorrow, or would we say, nope, we're not selling it because that's not what we want it to be used for?
I will tell you what administration's recommendation would be. Welcome to Shakopee.
Exactly.
All right. Final comments on this example here, Mark?
The uncertainty about that home between the Laurent and the city parcel is, that's where I'm stumbling, because if the person isn't interested in selling, mm-hmm. then we're kind of stuck.
Mm-hmm.
If they're interested, then that opens up that block quite a bit more. So that's where I would feel a little bit better if I knew more about what their long-term plan is. But if they're set to stay and it's, then we're...
Isn't it rental property now, or?
I'm not sure, John.
So we could send a city representative there. I do believe that 1410 is owned by the folks that own the Laurent building now. Laurent wanted to expand at one time, and I think they purchased the home that was on 1410 and demoed that. And I don't know much about 1420, but I know it's been there a long time, and a resident lives there, but...
1420 is a rental property.
Oh, rental.
And...
That makes it easier.
And the Laurent building and the parcel to the west of it are both owned by the same owner.
All right, let's move forward.
This is the 900 First Avenue East block. Again, there's multiple parcels here, multiple owners. This is First Avenue East. This is Dakota Street. This is Bluff Avenue. This is the former Saba's, Main Event, Richard's Pub, many different things over the years. You'll notice that the parking on the north side is partially on the parcel to the north. So some of the parking for that lot is not available if the property owner of the north is not interested in leasing to a commercial user. That's been something, there's been a fair amount of interest in this site. It is currently bank owned. And then the properties to the east here are owned by another property owner. So this is five lots here. They also own this middle parcel. There was a house here that burned down several years ago. And then
that was demolished, yeah.
And then this is the bar site that's being marketed right now by the bank. Without the parking to the north, it's a much more challenging site. But you could look at assembly of some of these sites that there's willing sellers and willing buyers. You could look at the small portion of the site or a very large portion of the block.
What is it zoned?
It is all zoned B1 highway business.
Jay?
Couple questions. Do we know if the owner of 90 is holding out for his desired use of the old Saba's building, or is he just not
Mayor
interested?
Mayor Mars, Councilor Whiting, I have no idea what the...
It's probably an income for him, you know?
Well, it's not now. Well, maybe it is being leased. Yeah,
it.
That's true. The other part of this is we have some very historic houses here. We have one of the most historic houses in Shakopee sitting on that site.
What's the name of that house?
Which number?
It's the architect in,
yeah.
in
Rolf.
Rolf House.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'd
that
have
the
a hard
right
time
on
with that
First
one.
Avenue?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, all right, yeah.
I mean, you can always move them, but wow, that would be hard for me. And then the house back on 90 is also... I believe that's painted Shakopee brick house. I think that's the one with the foundation of the basement is bedrock, as I recall from our.
Or the one off of Bluff.
Yep.
That used to be. The hell is her name?
So to me, it's a really delicate site.
Yeah.
And then the historic house off of 101, that's in the last two go rounds. That's been a business.
Mm-hmm.
Combination house business, people live there
and
run their business.
This is portrait studio and photographer at this point.
Mm-hmm.
It was previously a thrift store.
Carousel.
Yeah, it was designer carousel.
Kyle, what's the building to the left across the street? What's that?
That's KFC.
Thank you.
And then this is actually adjacent to the property we were talking about earlier. We were talking about the adjacent parking or parking
site.
Lot
yep.
across. What's that the 010 there across the street?
010. Oh, that's
is that an ice cream
site.
Shop or what is
oh, that?
City owned
ice cream
shop.
Ice cream
shop.
Future ice cream shop. Yeah.
And
you,
I think that's two lots too, by the way.
Doesn't look like it.
Well, this is, to me, this is a whole city block, a couple different owners, complicated piece. I know earlier we were talking about making part of that into a parking lot to, if the Bluff Street, I look at some of this old stuff and go, what is the barriers? What are the, like the old bar, why hasn't that turned? Why, you know.
Parking.
What are the barriers? What's holding it back?
Well, the reputation of that bar is so bad that.
But it doesn't have to be a bar.
When it was Richard's Pub, years and years ago, the parking lot was full and it was a Red Owl parking lot, kitty corner that they used. Very successful. It was the spot of town.
Mm-hmm.
So I.
You're dating yourself.
I don't know if people, well, you're the same age, so.
Mark?
It was fun.
I don't know if there's, I saw a hand go up in the audience. I don't know if you wanted to comment.
The cops are really bad.
Yeah, they were. They'd park. They'd sit in that parking lot too. Yeah.
I have a question for Kyle. Is that the lot that the Photoshop is on now with the big opening in the back, is that platted as one lot like that? Or is
it
multiple
all.
Lots?
It's multiple lots and they've been combined at the county, I believe, by PID. So it's considered one parcel at this time.
The alley has been vacated.
And the alley has been vacated.
And I believe they own 70.
Do you know what the purpose of doing that was?
The guy owns 70, so he's could be getting it ready personally behind the scenes.
Mm-hmm.
By creating only one lot, buying the property, you know, maybe.
No, because that was done in the past, not by the folks that own it now, the Photoshop.
Well, is the Photoshop the owner, or are they leasing
Photoshop, it? I believe, leases it.
Yeah.
Mike, comments on this property?
I think so, but I thought he died.
For staff, I believe you know the number that the bank is wanting for the old bar.
I want to say it was $299,000. One of the concerns or constraints of the use of that site is it is not fire sprinklered. And in order to, if the use of the site changes to something other than a bar, then it needs to be sprinklered, and there's challenges in getting sprinkler service for that. Would need to be bored underneath First Avenue for the to have a larger water service.
That or put a tank in the building.
Wow.
Yeah, Tom's aware of that, and then there's also the possibility of going to the east through other parcels to connect to a water main in Prairie Street as another opportunity, but that has its challenges running through other properties. Use of the site as a bar, or other commercial sites,
parking.
As I mentioned, the parking is an issue.
You're back to square one. So, in this area, this was one of the first ones that we saw where we were looking to the north there, which I think may have some potential, but then if we looked at higher density housing here, it would, then I'm looking at, you know, three bigger buildings in a very close proximity. And I know that through our discussions as a council over the last month at these workshops, we've been thinking about, you know, dissipating that, spreading that out a little bit. So why I'm all for development, I just would look at this and go, maybe not. Any other comments, Mark?
I like that northeast area as a potential residential development. Yes, as you stated, there's three potential sites here, but the NHHI has minimal impact on traffic, and I think that northeast site could develop well as a nice multifamily site. It's off Main Street, so is it really going to develop for commercial? Probably not. As Kyle stated, they don't have the exposure on First Avenue, so I think that could be a real nice site. And I'd like to see something happen with the old Saba's building. It's just getting through the utility issues. What happens there?
Matt?
We seem to have something floating up to the surface here. And it's existing uses that are not being used because if they want to use them for a different use in the same structure, it's almost cost prohibitive to bring it up to code. So that's one issue. The second issue is, even if you did want to use that building for a different use, what's it going to cost to bring this underneath the road? You know, that's turning people away. So, and even if you tore it down and put something different there, the same issue is going to exist for the bare land to be developed in whatever you want to use it for. So I think we're going to find that all the way through downtown. And at some point, we're going to have to find out, probably ask Spuck and engineering, you know, where are these water lines at? Where's the low-hanging fruit here? Because we're looking at properties thinking about redeveloping or whatever, reusing more, even just reusing the existing structure for something different. And it's almost cost prohibitive just to get the sprinkler systems in and so on and so forth.
Well, the sprinkler system, I believe, is a state law, is it not?
Because of our insurance classification.
Then you hook up to a bigger water line, you have the water access charge, and then we've had discussions that spoke about some economic development.
You're allowed to not have that if you're the existing same use. So does it make sense for a bar that's doesn't have a sprinkler system can still be used today by a new owner as a bar without a sprinkler system? But if a new owner...
Makes no sense.
It doesn't make no sense. But if a different owner wants to come in and make a, you know, gift shop or something, gotta have a sprinkler system. All right, I'm going to sell alcohol right over here. Got one bottle and two glasses. Here's my card shop. Okay, you're a bar.
No, but my point is the sprinkler system is a state law, state requirement.
But every it's not required on the current use on the site or a future buyer to use it as the same use. That's where it doesn't make no sense.
Right.
And even if it was required, which it's not, some of these sites are almost cost prohibitive to put it in there.
Well, that site is cost prohibitive because there was a grocery store that wanted to move in there and they couldn't afford it.
Right. So we're gonna have to figure that issue out. If maybe that's part of the reason some of these properties don't do anything, you know. And if that's the case, we need to know that, figure out what we can do about that, because that's gonna be a hamper for anything, whether it's somebody taking an existing site and reusing it, or tearing it down and building something new, or whatever the case might be. We're gonna have to figure that one out, because that would explain why a lot of these sites sit empty.
Okay. Other comments, Ken?
Mayor, I like Mark's comments about the northeast piece. I think that is a good candidate. Councilmember Whiting is noting the house that's on 101 that's historic, and I think that's at least we have to be aware of that. Going through the development, I like the site, that northeast part. I think that has some potential.
I Mark, to follow up, I asked Kyle to put the this map up that shows the services. You can see the water line.
Water line is in blue. You can see there's the line along Prairie Street here, and then also on the towards the south side of First Avenue, and that's where this is the bar building. They would have to bore underneath to hook to get a new service, or go through Prairie Street.
Or could they bring it from Bluff down and over to Prairie? I mean, what ideally? You see, if that northeast corner develops, that might help trigger getting the utilities to the former Saba's site, and you could see both pieces actually benefit from some new utility services.
I got to watch the water line get put in from down Prairie Street to First Avenue.
Yeah.
It was three crane chisel heads over the course of about a month.
Right.
Just to go that half a block. So the problem is there.
Okay.
It's going to be difficult. That's all it's going to be, you know.
Mike?
I think of any of this, if you go north of that site across Bluff to where we looked previously, that's the better site.
Mm-hmm.
This one here doesn't work for so many reasons. The one on the riverfront would,
I
can see that being more saleable to residential.
But add your parking lot question to the northeast corner could be utilized for both.
Right. It's funny because I think that open green space there that we were just talking about on the northeast side makes a lot of sense, but not, I wouldn't want in total three big buildings here. And I do agree that it'd be great if you could use one of those lots as parking. Which one do you pick? You do the Bluff Street and then use.
But if you accumulated those houses along Bluff up to the one metal shed building with the ironworks in it, you would have plenty of room for your parking on that side. I mean, you could put up a fairly, you know, a two-sided building and still have your parking all along the south side along Bluff.
Then at some point you'd have to ask, what upgrades would Bluff be required to have at what point? When does it get sewer or storm sewer and curb and gutter and everything else? And what's that cost compared to what the revenue that you're gaining? And you're going to be upside down.
Mm-hmm. Didn't they just redo some of the storm sewer down there a couple of years ago?
They didn't put curb and gutter in.
No, but they did storm sewers, I believe.
Yeah.
So they did in one section between Stockers and the ornamental guy down that way, north.
Okay.
And I think they went over a little bit across to that building right on the corner between his building and the auto body shop. It's limited. It wasn't the whole thing.
Mm-hmm. All right.
That's coming as you develop, which is going to be a pretty big capital cost for the city.
Okay. Moving forward.
Okay. Okay, the next site we've talked about briefly before, it's the City and SS Design site. This is at the intersection of First Avenue and Scott Street. This is a city-owned parcel that Levy Drive runs through. So as part of development of the site, you'd potentially be looking at revising the alignment of Levy Drive, because right now a good amount of it runs through and would limit the developability of the site. SS Design site, the two buildings and parking lot have been for sale on and off. I'm not sure if they're still being marketed. Right now, Doggy Doo's is in the larger building, and then they use the parking area, and then this is the dog play area in the back. But SS Design owns all of these properties, and I know that they were marketing this one as well. So potentially you'd look at development of the city site, and this could be used for parking. That's a possibility. You've got the direct river view on the site. It is a smaller site, but it's something that certainly could be a possibility. It's directly across or has access to the state trail, and then that can take you right to Huber Park and to the Holm Street Tunnel. It's currently zoned B1.
So what's with the 870 little piece up top there where the road is?
Believe that's owned by the city and it's just for the right of way, but I can take a look here.
There's some power line concerns there.
They're more to the north.
You got them running down the alley, but
yeah, power lines run through the alley.
Right.
That's the high.
Run through the alley.
That's the high voltage lines, ain't it?
Right.
How did this property get acquired by the city?
Probably when they put that road in.
Mayor Mars, Councilor Mokel, I'm not sure how the city acquired it.
Mike?
Well, I look at that site and I go, you know, we could vacate Levy Drive for that section. They've got access to 101 at the next street, so that would square that up nicely.
As long as you can get out the alley and turn up for the trucks coming out of RAR.
Yeah, I wouldn't, yeah, just to the north side, not to the west
this
side.
This is an overhead view.
Is that green light? Is the green?
Yes, when we saw this.
The green is storm sewer.
Yeah.
Storm sewer would have to be moved.
When I saw this site earlier, I was going, it's too small, but with the combined with the SS, but to live in an apartment building right here to overlook the river.
Boy, I'd love that.
That'd be the cat's meow. Mike, more comments on this?
No, I agree with you. That would be one of the better sites for visibility.
Yeah, how much are two bedrooms?
Huh?
It'd be great. I think it'd be a great spot.
So this is just shy of 0.6 acre.
It wouldn't be much of a building, though.
What would it be with SS Designs property?
Right.
Be 0.86 of an acre, or 0.76 of an acre.
I mean their whole.
Oh, shoot, match.
Oh, the whole?
So you'd be just about an exact acre.
Maybe about the 40 units, or?
You'd be a little over an acre.
Yeah.
Right in there.
Right.
You'd be at about 1.1.
And actually, remove the road, but with the sewer there, but you could, you know, the curve of the street gives a little character there. I don't know if they would care about that, but Jay, any other comments on this?
Nope.
Mark?
I think it's an ideal multifamily. Even if you didn't have to move the sewer, that might be an area that there could be setbacks, so it might not need to be, but I think you could do a nice project here with some great visibility.
Matt?
I don't know. You'd have to work through the issues. I mean, would the power lines stay, or would there be a cost to moving them? You'd have to try to figure out if you could leave them there. I think assembling all the properties on the south side of that lot would be probably difficult. I think the business that's in that brown building has probably got a lease of some length.
Yeah, Steve has made some improvements to the building as well. That's why on the site I had just the house listed and not the not the larger building.
And they were talking about combining them three lots that SS owns, and I think the parking lot that they're utilizing for the business there is probably included in their lease, which takes that one out of the picture, at least until their lease is up.
But, you know, developers are pretty creative on that. Mm-hmm. You know, they could buy the whole property and then with the lease included.
They could buy an empty lot sitting down here too.
I know. Well, a lot of these sites have a lot of opportunity and they have a lot of obstacles.
But as far as visibility to the river, this one's got an all beat.
Yeah, I think that if tomorrow we said we want multifamily here, we're guiding for multifamily, I think somebody'd take a long run at it.
Where's the water at to this property?
First Avenue.
You'd be coming off of First Avenue. Or you could run through the alley here.
And Kyle, the building right to the right of that, just for everybody, what's that building to the right?
That's 200 Levy Drive.
Yeah.
So it's six levels, 66 units of senior housing.
Thank you.
And this is a city-owned parking lot here.
Thank you.
Do you have more comments on this?
No, I like
Kathy?
The site.
I like this site.
Huh? All right. Why should just the seniors have a good view?
Huh? Well, you could move in. Yeah, I'd be calling it, we're going to move in early, right?
Yeah. Next site is the Sweeney site. It's been, there's a multitude of parcels down here. Many of them aren't buildable. The upper portion is what's highlighted in yellow. There's existing structures, there's historic homes here. They've been marketed for a long time. This is on Bluff Avenue. This is Minnesota Street right here. And this is Market Street. The city owns this parcel here to the west. And the state trail runs on the north side. And this is the marina here. Now, the sites are zoned R2 right now, which is medium density residential. The total of the upland area is just over an acre. Again, there's existing structures and historic structures on this block, but it's all one property owner. Directly on the trail, potentially have some views of the river. So there's some strengths on this site as well as some weaknesses.
Mike?
Yeah, the units to the south across Bluff Avenue, that side of that block, I know that's for sale also. So that'd be a pretty good chunk of property somebody could.
Which one?
It would be 40580 and 40570.
Oh, both of.
See, Conradi's and what's the other one?
Mansky's.
Jay?
I'd have a hard time doing anything with this site. I know it's been for sale forever, and it's some more historic, very historic houses for the Brickyard area, and yeah, I'd have a hard time with this.
I think the reason it hasn't sold though is because they're trying to market it with the marina, which, you know, people have tried to make that a marina a number of times, and it just
won't let it happen.
A tough sell.
In
can
fact,
you can you put the street overlay from the old streets over this? Just I want to show the mayor something, maybe get him around.
Or it fills in with Sultan.
Yeah.
Well, the requirements nowadays are so much different than they were back in.
Oh, I know. Yeah. Well, I've never been back in there.
Mm-hmm.
Stomping grounds.
That's the kettle hole. That's what they call that marina.
Well, it's not on this one, but if you go back to some of the older maps, there's three streets past Bluff going north.
Wow.
Yeah.
Due north.
Right. They're all in the floodplain, so they never went.
Okay, that's I wasn't sure what you were mentioning, but yes, Councilor, there's
plat.
Vacated right of ways that if you pan over to Huber Park, you can see that there's additional street right of ways here. Congress Street, Spring Street, and Water Street. They're not shown here. They've been vacated in this area. But going further to the west, towards where the original Dairy Queen was, there's several streets, the right-of-ways that are there today but are owned by the DNR.
That's when the plat disappeared and came back with all these different lots and blocks so that someone wanted to make some money. So
that road right there where your cursor is, well, let me move. Which road is that? Minnesota Street.
That road from Bluff down past Marina.
Yeah, this is Market.
To the river. Nope, the other one. To the.
This is Minnesota.
That one. Yep, Minnesota. From Bluff Street down to the river. I've driven that one last year.
Last year?
Yep.
Now, some of those right-of-ways have been vacated.
On a test drive?
No.
With the
property owner's permission.
Well, obviously the city
like
overbuilt
right
the infrastructure
the
years ago.
And they never overbuilt.
They overplanned them.
Overplanned.
It's too wet.
Let's go. Keep going around. Mark, on the Sweeney property?
I'm with Councilmember Whiting about those homes, just having served on the Historic Preservation Commission. I know the significance of those structures. You know, ideally, to me, they either stay as historic homes or they are converted into shops or offices in those structures. What I'm more interested about is this parcel to the west, which the city owns, which it's higher up and flat here. It does go down a bluff, but
there's a spring there too.
There's more challenges here in this area than there is on the Sweeney site.
Yeah.
There's more challenges?
On the city owned piece.
Yeah.
That where these trees are, it drops off significantly and there's a spring right here.
Right. Yeah. But I'm looking at the south portion of that. There could be something nice put up there with a nice view towards Huber Park and some
of
those.
Pretty small.
Right. It would require several variances.
Right.
Well, and if you took the westernmost part of the piece we were just talking about, that home is not historic. That's probably built in the 50s or 60s.
That's
got
our
original.
This one.
Tim.
Yeah, right.
That was Tim.
Sweeney.
Okay.
Yep.
That's got a brick
comments on this?
Well, it's R2. And it used to be commercial, so under the commercial zoning, anybody that wanted to buy it, since it's for sale, would have had a better opportunity to have a variety of things to do with it than just a standard R2 zoning that's currently on it. Is that right? Currently R2?
It is currently R2, and it has been the entire time I've worked here.
Okay. Does the overlay apply to that?
I believe it's guided for medium density residential. It's not guided for mixed use.
Okay.
I think a lot of the barriers are the, you know, the cost of demolition or the historic aspect of it or the cleanup, I don't know.
You got a big kiln back there too.
Yeah, the kiln is...
Kiln is to
square.
The east.
The kiln's to the east.
Isn't that the square next, right there?
Right there.
Yep. It's right
what
here.
What is in there?
The old...
The brick kiln is right here.
What's left right of it.
Okay.
And then across the... No, it's
to
right
the,
there.
It's at Stan Steer's house.
Yep. East of Minnesota, and then on the other side, north of the trail, is where the old brickyard is.
That box
so,
is
we used to climb them down there.
Too many problems here.
Too many problems?
Yeah, I think a lot of problems on this.
Kathy?
I'm not excited about this one.
You know, as I've been in our community for 25 years, I've looked at these areas and thinking, wow, that'd be great. But then I look at them more like I drive down Bluff and I've been to the city-owned lot. A lot of challenges, but I always, think that if I can put the land to the highest and best use, there's got to be an opportunity there. But I've never put the numbers to it, but... And obviously, how long has the Sweeney property been, for sale as well? I mean, Matt?
Walt Sweeney and I will go back and sit by the river next to that marina and daydream about what could be there. an operational marina where folks can come down the river, stop at the marina, get out, have a businesses on the bottom, a hamburger shop type thing.
Yeah.
Maybe a small gas station, fill up the boat. Residential above, walk up, maybe a couple of rental cars. Take your cars, run uptown, do whatever you're going to do. A couple of little shanty shacks for camping out or something. There's opportunity, it just all costs money, and to get that marina to operate is going to be pretty costly.
Mm-hmm. So it's been 40 years since that's operated? You'd have to get it.
I've got a picture of it in operation at home in my office. Wow. I'll share with you. It's full of boats, big boats.
You'd have to come in and dredge that out
now.
And,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And I think with the river, unfortunately, I grew up on Lake Superior, and a lot of marinas were tucked in a river system of a city or something. And when you have a river that passes by your opening constantly, the sediment builds up, and almost that dredging is a yearly thing, or
mm-hmm.
and it's not cheap.
You have to build them so that it's turned like that.
A hook.
So that the flow is going this way,
right.
And then there's a certain way that you put your walls in like this.
Yeah.
I mean, he's had people down there, engineers and the DNR and all that, telling them it would have to be, I think they said it would be a rock wall, a cement wall, and a wood wall, and it's like, it's pretty expensive.
The only other thing I would say is this, is that in this part of town, if we are able to build a project on one of these lots, maybe not this one, that I think that once it's up and going,
yeah.
that,
mm-hmm.
that we would then, other people would take a renewed look at a lot of this.
No, and I've always said that but it's just slow. We built that apartment building came in that we looked at. Also, the CDA has built some properties down more to the east, and you'd think there'd be some, synergy there and energy, and it's taken a long time. More?
The last site I can pull up here. I didn't have an oblique aerial photo for it, but it'd be the City Hall site. Can go back. So, current City Hall, corner of Holmes Street and Lewis, or Holmes and Second, sorry. And the site acreage is 0.66 acres. Zoned B3, you've got a significant building on the site. It's also adjacent to the railroad tracks, but it is also in the heart of the downtown. So this
we
could
get a little encroachment on the east there.
Yeah, from what I understand, that there was a swap to allow. allow
that alley to go through, yeah.
A drive-through.
Yeah, I was just messing with them.
Essentially, I think what had happened is that we took this and we gave that and then we took that, or the other way around.
Been there since I can remember.
So now across the back parking lot, Bill's Toggery is right on the other side of this, is that right?
Yep. This is Bill's Toggery to the east. This is Arnie's, and this is Turtles here, and this is the O'Brien Building and former pet store.
Thank you.
Again, if this was R4D at .66, I think you'd be looking at, you know, 30 to 34 units, if you could get them all in there, and 45 feet of height. I think as our community, as we move forward with a new city hall, I think this creates a great opportunity on this building, whether it gets repurposed or razzed in a building, because this puts it right in the heart of downtown, bring a lot new energy, more people. I think this is a great opportunity right here on this site over the next many years. Mike?
Just a hard sell with the tracks. We know what it's like here when we're having meetings and the train goes by.
You know, I guess I'm hemming and hawing here a little bit about what do we owe. Do we owe businesses for downtown to create more business, or do we want more people to go to the businesses? And I guess I'm not sure. I think maybe more of a reuse as a business would be better for this.
I think downtown needs everything, and I do think that one thing that's missing is people.
Yeah,
we're talking about
young people.
How many employees do we have as a city here in this building?
In this building, about
30.
Yeah. So if you had an apartment building that had 30 or 35, 34 units, whatever, they could get on .66 at two people. Now you're looking at 60. Tell you, if I was a business downtown, I'd be gone.
I don't think you limit yourself. I think you, if you get the opportunity to sell it for a business reuse, fine. If somebody wants to tear it down and build something else, fine.
No, I agree.
Yeah.
I guess I think developers today are always looking for the highest and best use of their land, of their property.
I disagree. Like, they're looking at how to make a buck.
Well, I do, but they...
But with the highest and best use.
They don't care about the use. They want to make a buck. They want to make money.
Jay, did you want to finish your comment?
No, I think, I've agreed with everything everybody said on that, so I guess I'm still not sure.
Mark?
If it was an empty piece of property, I'd love to see commercial on the street and then residential above.
Right.
It'd be perfect for that.
Yeah, I agree.
That's not...
But since it's not, then what?
Yeah, reused as business in its present shape.
Matt, more comments on this?
No, I'd take either or option.
Yep.
I agree with Mark. I think it'd be wonderful. I mean, in a perfect world, commercial on the ground and housing on top. I think it'd be wonderful.
Kathy?
I agree with that, and I also think that parking lot would be a great plaza for activity.
Well, one of the pluses also is that remember that we have a very expansive basement already dug.
Yep.
With a vault in it.
Yep.
Back in States.
That's not a plus.
You just took my plus and made it a negative.
It's not a very good basement, really.
Or it's a huge basement.
Doesn't matter. Business incubator. I mean.
Mike?
Well, I guess we're talking about the building and we're talking about repurposing or doing the retail and would we entertain some cut in price if somebody wanted to do that for this building?
To repurpose it?
No, to take it down and put basically mini River City Center up.
It's up to us.
Bring an offer.
I might look at that real hard. It's funny, I do vision our city over the next many years of getting a new city hall, and number one, not a city hall that's a bank. Or, you know, we've gone from bank to bank, and we've outlived the general use of the building now, I think, twice, but I agree that I think that this spot is unique because it's right in the core downtown. We have some new shops, new businesses here. You put 80 people here with maybe some businesses and shops. I think a great opportunity. Kathy?
No, I agree.
Yeah. I don't disagree. I just think you're going to have a hard sell to sell this building to somebody to tear it down.
Mm-hmm. So you think that the only would be just to repurpose the building?
I can't speak for all the
no.
trillionaires out there, but I just don't see somebody buying this building to tear it down. It's not in that bad a shape. I mean, it doesn't serve the city well, but I mean, we've kept up on the maintenance and the heaters and these types of things and air conditioning
right.
units. I just can't see, you know. But I'm not a developer.
But it doesn't mean that they don't buy it and add a top. You know, that's, you know, anything can go.
I thought we had that discussion once before that they really couldn't go up with this building without, it wasn't designed for the load carrying to go up.
Can't go up in this existing
building. Right.
And the other thing about it is just, again, the railroad tracks. You know, it's one thing to repurpose the building, but if you're going to do what I think might go there, then a developer would have to say, well, now mm-hmm. how do I get around that? You know,
the old hotel used to be over here in the next block, over where the parking lot is.
Yeah,
is that block or is it that next block?
East.
Oh, that's right there.
Right there. Yeah.
The fire station was on the corner. Then. Yeah.
So you lost that too. So. A hotel down here wouldn't be a bad idea. Not a stop in for the night hotel,
right.
but like an apartment building style. So yeah, that could work here too.
Well, we've generated a lot of ideas tonight. Now we need some investors to come and mm-hmm. and try that. And
get your wallet out, Mr. Mars.
A risk reward thing, and they do look at. I do believe yes, they are interested in making money, and they do it through the. Highest and best use of the land. I do think, though, that tonight we have identified some properties that could be under discussion. I also think that we've really looked at some that found some difficulties too. That probably aren't going to, be a spot. Mike,
I think along First Avenue corridor, if we could get one of them in here, it would spur the development of more because you know mm-hmm. the first guy is afraid to do it.
Yep.
Once he sees it done, then.
Mayor, I'm just wondering about next steps. You were just talking about, you know, having all of these sites. Do we package all of these sites maybe with some challenges and opportunities and then show them to developers?
Well,
do we get the you know, pick five or six developers and say, what do you think of these? How do we do this?
Mike?
I think, like Mr. Reynolds said, the first thing we need to do is take all our city properties and decide, do we want them or do we want to sell them?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
okay.
then put them out there.
Okay.
Yeah. We can start.
Do we need, what else does anybody want to discuss about R4 and downtown? Mark?
I know Kyle's put a lot of effort right. into some schematics and
yeah.
he'd like to
yeah,
share
and that's,
that. It might give you an idea what
yeah.
kind of projects you could see in some of these areas.
So under the discussion points, the third one is do the differences in regulations between the R4, R4T, and R4D make sense? Now, we've provided some drawings for the council. I'll put them up on the document camera. What I've done is created two different site plans. One is a site plan of one block to show what does this look like. So this is one block. It's or a half of a block. It's 300 feet by 142 feet. Lot size is 42,600 square feet or 0.98 of an acre. Showed a building which would be a 39 unit building that meets the setbacks and there's enough parking shows the, there's 26 surface parking stalls, and there are 39 internal parking stalls.
Is that underground?
Yes, they're underground parking. There's the 24-foot drive, 24-foot drive aisle. So you can see there's a street frontage on three sides, and then an alley.
This is an example like what we're looking at on the north side of Second along the tracks.
The first couple lots that we looked at, there were a half a block. One had a building on it, one was.
So this is a concept of what would it look like if a developer came in and maximized the site under the current regulations. So this would be 39 units. The maximum impervious surface in the R4D is 75%. As developed, this site is 61.8%, so there's additional green space. Yes, Councilor Wynn?
Current regulations. You mean
current regulations
of the R4? Okay.
This is the R4D.
Okay, thank you.
So if a property along Second Avenue or multiple properties were assembled into a site this large, this is what it would look like. So there's the surface parking stalls. There's basically a listing of the setbacks. The setbacks are shown in gray dot dash lines. There's the 22.5-foot setback for the structure, which is shown here. And that's based on a 45-foot tall building. There's the 15-foot front parking setback. And then there's a 5-foot rear or side parking setback. You see there's street frontages, so there's additional green space. The footprint of the building is 16,896 square feet. And the notes for the levels would be level one is parking, level two is 11 units, rental office, maintenance, and amenities. And then floors three and four would be 14 units. I've also created a building schematic for which would be the third and fourth floors. So to see what we're looking at for sizes of units at 39 or at 40 units per acre to show that these aren't, again, this is maximizing. So a developer using the most of the building, they're not small units. As a reference, I put the Addison unit sizes. A one-bedroom unit in Addison is 725 to 875 square feet. A two-bedroom and two-bath is 975 to 1213. A three-bedroom, two-bath is 1235 to 1382. So you'll see the different listings of the areas. The white is the hallway. There's a mechanical and stairs and the elevator. There's a couple studio units. But otherwise, it is a mix of two-bedroom and one-bedroom units, and they're good-sized units. Now, this would be a maximum utilization of a building, and there's also the there would also be enough square footage for amenities on the level two to get that bonus to be up to 40 units per acre. So there's three less units on level two. This is just purely as a concept. It is scalable. 1 inch equals 20 feet. And you can see the dimensions of the building.
This is great. I just like the concept of how you're laying, at least presenting this. What were the amenities?
Amenities could be anything. It could be a game room, community room, fitness area.
Laundry.
Would you give up one of these rooms for that? Is that what you're saying, one of these apartments?
No, they'd be on first floor.
On first floor, okay.
Yep. So this is just a floor plan of the third and fourth level. So there's 14 units on this, and then on the ground, on level two, there would be 11 units. So there'd be 3,000 square feet, roughly, or a little over 3,000 square feet that would be converted to maintenance area, storage, and amenities. So, to show what a site plan may look like if a developer were to maximize it. So there's enough green space. Really overall, it shows that our regulations can work. and it's a marketable, and it would be a marketable product, that there isn't, more than likely we may not even see a request for 40 units per acre. But if there is, it's not, it wouldn't be an unreasonable place that nobody would want to live. Or you're not looking at all studio units by packing people in. So it's comparable to, the Addison is 18 units per acre, this would be 40 units per acre. So this is, I can turn over to the council for any questions on the site plan or the building. Otherwise, I have a smaller site.
Again, we've got to put this into perspective. What we have in front of us is a proposal that would require acquisition of multiple lots, in most cases. Just tear down of existing structures, if there are any. A full basement for a garage in bedrock. And God knows what the services are going to cost to get there. So no matter wherever you put this downtown, it's going to be, I just don't see it happening. There's way too many difficulties in it from, I just don't see somebody come stepping forward and doing that. I just don't see somebody buying a property, hoping the next one sells, sitting on this one paying taxes on it for 5 years until that one sells, probably overpay for that one because that one's got them over a barrel, basically. Then paying to tear them down, then finding out there's bedrock underneath it and digging a hole. I just don't see it. I mean,
that's one concept or one project that's familiar, that's close, where a developer has done that would be O'Brien's Public House.
Mm-hmm.
Scott O'Brien purchased multiple properties not outside of mm-hmm. the public house mm-hmm. and had some of the same issues, removal of a house,
yep.
Installation of a parking lot, refurbishing a house into...
Putting a parking lot in is a lot different
yep.
than digging an underground parking garage
in that's
bedrock.
Right.
Yep. There's also...
Substantially different.
Kathy?
I think it's a completely... If you want to say that there's a free market and then now sit here and say, well, nobody's going to want to do it, I don't think that's the right answer. You're saying it's a free market, but then let that market be there. Don't just say, oh, nope, it can't be done now.
Fair enough. But I'm also realistic.
So am I.
Mike?
And B was first.
Oh, Mark? Just clarifying, Kyle, level one parking, that's not below grade, correct? Is that...
Yes, Mark or Mr. Noble, Mayor Mars, that's that wouldn't necessarily be below grade. This would be a four-level structure, maximum height of 45 feet. So if it was a flat roof, it would meet that requirement with a pitched roof. Depending on if there's shallow bedrock, there could be some excavation. Some of the multifamily or the senior housing in town has underground parking.
Underground parking, yeah. Mark? Okay. Mike?
Well, I spoke to the developer late this afternoon, and he told me that on most sites, if they go over $500,000 to buy and tear down, that's their limit.
That's one developer.
What, to acquire a piece of property?
Right.
And to tear down, their limits, okay.
Yeah, to make it feasible, he said that would be their limit.
Is that per acre?
Right.
Yes.
No, this is an example. Kyle, I appreciate you putting this together. This is a visual for us. This isn't a building. And developers are going to come and make their own project and make their own numbers and decide whether or not it's feasible or not. So for an example, I think I appreciate you putting this together so I have something to look at. I think it's our duty to say whether or not we want this and then let everybody else work. But that's all I
mean. Yeah, I think that, you know, the bedrock is an issue, but we've seen developments in our community where it happens. The apartment building that we were looking at, the latest parking lot that's down by your shop, or we were looking off of Bluff Street, they had bedrock issues. The CDA has built a building or so here that had, you know, bigger ones that had deeper foundation.
They got deeper pockets too.
Well,
they got taxpayer pockets.
And one thing that our town sometimes has missed is somebody with deep pockets that had a lot of vision that gonna make stuff happen. And maybe it's not any of us, but I agree that this looks reasonable. Now, just to say that they can't do it,
I'm not saying they can't do it. I'm saying it's going to be difficult, and I'd like to see us know what them challenges are. I mean, we don't even know where the water lines are, except they got one underneath First Avenue and down a block.
Worried about the rock issue. That's the land issues that go with it. And then if you're going to, you know, this in these examples, some of these are mixed use and that. When you're given the developer almost a lot of flexibility, or R3, which is, you know, not necessarily the best and highest use of the land, but the incentive is it's not one unit per acre, it's higher, and that can help you through your difficult issues. Jay? Mike?
Matt and myself, living here all our lives, we understand the limitations to the bedrock. Another thing to remind people of with the bedrock, it's not all at one level. It's like a lake. It moves. Mm-hmm. Some places it's deeper, some places it's right up at the surface.
Right.
So, you know, the developer's going to have to do some core drilling, find out where it's at so they know what they can do.
And then, so in Shakopee then, in the downtown area mainly, are we just looking at on-slab buildings then?
No, that's up to them. It's just a matter of, we're just trying to be conscious of the fact that it does cost more to do it.
No, and we're fully aware that we
and slab is fine too, but they're going to need parking then,
right?
You know,
and we experience that as a city when we build infrastructure where it's more, you know, we just talked earlier about boring through the streets and for our sewer or water, those infrastructure costs are.
If I was a developer and I was going to do something downtown here on a lot with a building on it, I'd bulldoze it, I'd put a slab on grade, and I'd start building. And I'd put a outside parking.
Right.
And one of the comments that I like to make is, as far as with this specific building, just because it's cover parking doesn't mean it's underground parking. It's a level of the building, and so then the lowest floor of the first floor of dwelling units would be at your second level.
Mike?
I stopped over this weekend and looked at the one that Carver's building and by their transit station, and that's what they did. I think they maybe got 3 or 4 feet in the ground, and then the rest is above, and then they went up
from
there.
Okay.
And that's how Southwest Station is that way in Eden Prairie.
Yeah. You have more?
I also have, so this is knowing that there's multiple different sites and different sizes and looking to see how it works. This is a site that would be three lots, so three city lots, so it'd be 180 feet by 142 feet, and you're looking at it be a total of 24 units. So level one would be parking, level two would be 6 units, office, maintenance, and amenities, level three would be 9 units, and level four would be 9 units. So got 180 feet. On the top for the lots, 142 feet, it is a corner lot. There's a 22.5 foot building setback for a 45 foot tall building. There'd be 26 surface parking spaces, 24 foot wide drive. The drive for the parking area goes out to the alley. Lot size is 0.59 of an acre. Maximum allowed is 24 units. So this would fit in with the size of sites that we were talking about earlier, and the amount of maximum impervious surface is 75%. And see the calculation to make it on there. I was just working on this, but it is underneath. It is below 70. It's actually below 70%. So this site can work. I've also got a floor plan that's on the letter-sized piece of paper. And you can see the different units here. This would be for the third and fourth floor. So you've got 1,253 square foot two bedroom, 1,144 square foot two bedroom, 800 square foot one bedrooms, a couple 600 square foot studios, and an 850 square foot one bedroom. There's stairs and an elevator. So this would be to show what the development under the maximum density in R4 on a smaller site would look like.
And allowing for the curve in the road, but this could be something we might see down on Levy Drive or, you know, with some variation on our city-owned lot.
Certainly. And this is just purely a concept that I drew up. Developers would say, well, we don't like these. These layouts are, we have a different building.
You're not the architect, but
I'm not, but it could fit on three lots, have the parking for it, and maybe your unit sizes are a bit different, but this is the maximum. So if the density was actually lower, you're looking at bigger unit sizes.
Mike?
That Levy Drive site, I can't believe that somebody's not going to want to build the same height as Levy Drive and get the full exposure of that riverfront. You know, they're going to come for zoning change and height restriction.
Height change.
Yeah.
But if it was something like this on that spot, I'd think from what I've heard tonight that there might be support for that. You still have the same issues, bedrock, parking, whether it's underground or just, you know, a little bit, or...
Well, that's why Levy Drive doesn't have underground parking.
Right.
And then looking at crafting the regulations, when I drafted them, knowing there'd be additional expense in the downtown area, that's why there's higher densities, reduced setbacks. There's additional costs, so a developer could spread out those costs over multiple units versus greenfield development.
Okay.
Any other questions on these site plans?
No.
So, as we discussed earlier, are there any sites currently primed for residential development? We've heard that there's some of the sites that the members of the council see as more attractive than others. Are there any other sites that may be appropriate in the future? That's something that anybody can... Councilor Whitten?
The only other thought was possibly, and I know it's already owned and already being used, but down on the... other side of RAR on the 3rd Avenue end, and possibly even, which I don't even think is city property, but if the culvert company ever decided to move out of there, a big, I think that's township though,
that's
right there.
Louisville, I believe.
Yeah.
Jackson.
Is it Jackson there?
Jackson there?
But,
Louisville.
You know, it might need a lift station, it might have bedrock issues, but, you know, maybe that's an annexation discussion or something like that. Or on the other side, on the Shakopee side, where it possibly could happen.
I just wanted to thank our staff and Kyle, particularly. A lot of work went into it and did a pretty good job. And I think we do have identified some sites tonight that anybody would look at. And now the question is, we know there's obstacles to them, bad ones, but now the question is what. Where do we go from here?
Do you have more?
Really, overall, there's been discussions about the different regulations, and overall, I'd just like to see that if the council sees that the R4 regulations and the R4D specifically, if they make sense, any revisions necessary, that based on now that we've had multiple discussions.
Yeah.
I've been consistent. I don't like 40 units per acre. I think the density is too high. The 24 is much more practical. I can see that going down in that little corner down there. I don't have a problem with parking on grade and building the building above it. That actually might make sense in some cases. I don't want to see them all clustered in one area. I do have a limit on how much I will support, and if I support any. But I think the comment being made that once the ball gets rolling, this is going to chain reaction throughout our whole downtown. I think that's extremely scary, identity changing and character changing of our community, and I don't support that. I think we've got an opportunity to do some other things that could be very unique for our community and especially our downtown, that haven't really been tried. I mean, they have sloppily been tried, and we've got a unique opportunity to take our First Avenue corridor and make it a probably one of the best in the area, small shop, mom and pop type strips. And you go one way or the other, or you try to do both. But I don't like all high density as far as the eye can see.
I don't think anybody's brought that up. I think
well, the comment was made that, you know, once you get one going, the rest is just going to take off. And I don't know if that's the vision. I disagree with that vision.
I don't think it was my comment, but I think the development. It didn't mean just R4 development.
No,
I think
we
just
talked about
business.
I don't think that concept that all of a sudden we're going to get 10 of these. I think it's very site-specific in uniqueness. I do, you know, I've heard tonight, maybe if there would be one, there could be another one. You always hope for that, but I go back to my comment earlier. Down along Bluff Drive, outside of the CDA over on Levy, we've had one apartment building, and we've had, actually, the CDA did 3 or 4 homes there. Mm-hmm. That's it in the last 20 years.
Mm-hmm. Well, you had Block 3 and 4. You had the 3 or 4 homes behind SA. You had Northridge Court, so you, and then there's one other one. So you've got,
you know, Henderson, but it's not. Let's say that there aren't 10 a year, there aren't 5 a year. Jay,
A few comments. I want to thank Kyle and Mark for putting all this stuff together. I want to thank Commissioner Robbins for being here. Appreciate you coming and joining in on the discussion. You know, we got to look at our First Avenue corridor study too, the 101 corridor study where we spent the money that we got to do that, and some of the discussion points that came out of there was density in downtown and getting more people downtown to help make it go and grow. So looking at that information from an independent study, from what we know from 30 years or more of talking about what we can do to help revitalize downtown, and to me, you know, it's going to be density, and it's going to be in my neighborhood. So understand that it's a concern of mine, but I think it's something that the city needs to grow with. So
a lot of the properties in this corridor downtown area right here where we're sitting are the oldest, and probably way overdue to be redeveloped themselves. So if you really wanted to do it right, you'd start right here. You'd start like Block 3 and 4. You'd do the other side of the street, do this whole couple blocks right here and match Block 3 and 4.
I disagree with that.
Well, of course you do. I mean, everybody doesn't want it in their backyard. I mean, they don't have a problem with redeveloping the other side for their gain here, but they have a problem with redeveloping here to gain somebody else. That's really what it comes. That's really what it comes down to.
Well, I think it is trying to be, to revitalize or continue to revitalize the downtown corridor. I think try to bring some, what I call dynamic, where more housing with, you know, more bodies that will shop and support downtown, which then may bring another business there, in a pretty good cycle. I also think when we look at the city, the infrastructure is already here. It's enhancing the infrastructure that we've already spent money on, and increasing building the tax base from that, and we just spent a bunch of money on the downtown study. We also spent a great deal of money, or the county did, on the 101 upgrade to try to make that a better streetscape.
Mayor, the other thing that hasn't been, that's new, is the river crossing.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know how much difference that will make. But I do note that we have had a developer, Mr. O'Brien, put some money and take some risks on projects, and I can't imagine one of the reasons wasn't that he thought there'd be traffic coming from Chaska and down the hill to go to his place. Now, I don't know what that has to do with anything, except that if more people come into town, they'll get interested in it, and so maybe that's the difference. Maybe that's one of the differences in all of these years, is that river crossing's done.
Well, the initial question is whether I would change anything that the RDR, is it RD?
R4D.
R4D. No, I wouldn't. I think that I could see this on properties in the downtown, in the corridor. I think that, you know, when you start looking at taxes, you know, we looked at the tax, the increase of tax base when we were looking at the sand development and how much more in taxes that was bringing. This is just another tax per acre that's larger than what we've seen. And I think those are things that we need to look at, a viability of our community.
And Councilor Mokel, this is the sheet that you had mentioned?
Yes, thank you.
This was what you saw earlier a couple meetings ago regarding traffic and also the property taxes of existing commercial uses in town. So you can see there's the different lot sizes, the different estimated average daily traffics, and also the property taxes. So that was something, this was a slide that Councilor Mokel had requested.
I think this is an important slide because it talks about taxes. There is some commercial in here, which
yes,
we don't always get the full value because of the fiscal disparities, which you'll see some information at the next meeting on the impact of fiscal disparities, at least on the commercial side. I think that the ADT for me is a just to put it in perspective, I know just the sands pays higher taxes in this configuration than it did if it would have gone business and we would have lost to fiscal disparities. Also, the higher impact of that commercial that could have been is actually the housing development is actually less impact.
Less traffic.
Mm-hmm.
I think that we've identified some spots at least downtown. What I'd like to do is we've tried to take this and tear it apart and talk about it segments. I'd like to have another meeting where we can try to bring it back together with the downtown included in this. I'd also like to point out that I'm going to put, and I know that City Administrator Reynolds put out an email to us all on the information about the comp plan that Mike Luce brought out. This stuff was adopted by our city back in 2009, so it's not really that old. They were talking about the need for about 2,100 units. I found this very valuable. Thank you. I'm going to encourage every council member and to reread these sections because this has already been adopted in our city, and I found the numbers more realistic from the Met Council that is looking to 2030, and the number that was thrown out before was generated by a developer that talked about a number that's going to be in the next couple of years that we don't actually, I can't put my hands on the actual whole study, so I don't have any context where that other number is. And that is proprietary information and not available to us.
No, Matt? I understand we started out with a riverfront community residential, zoned and built residential. Mm-hmm. The city came in and rezoned it commercial in 68, making the residential properties illegal non-conforming uses.
Uh-huh. That creates some problems.
Now we're turning around and taking the commercial properties and trying to make them residential again, except at a much higher density, but yet we're saying we want business.
But businesses want foot traffic.
Be people for
when
business.
You figure out what it is you want, you'll be changing
right.
It.
Right, but I agree with you, Matt, on that. We've almost come full circle, but the, you know, what has worked? I don't know what's worked because we haven't had enough sustainability on any of those aspects.
We've had a downtown four-block area that said we have too much traffic, build us a bypass.
Yeah.
So we built a $1 billion bypass. Yeah. And they complained that they don't have enough traffic.
Yeah.
So now we're going to build them a whole bunch of residential properties so they have foot traffic. Yeah. They wanted a park. We built them a park.
We're not building them.
Well, government, okay? Government in general, which is us at one level. But at some point, I mean, if you're going to have a long-term plan, and you can't because the longer you plan, the less accurate you'll be,
right.
And it'll get changed by somebody else and so on and so forth. So, whatever. I just
Mike?
Another thing we have to take in consideration, when we start putting all these residences in the downtown, we're needing more police protection, just per capita. Not saying that they're gonna be bad. I mean, one of our higher generating high rises is Levy Drive. Well, I guarantee it's not for gang fights. You know, it's all medical, they have to respond to them. Another study that Sam sent me shows the area in color codes, and we fall in a stable rental area. So it's not like we have to have them right now.
No, and I agree, but if we're doing work, I really feel the work that we're doing, though, is to get ready for our 2040 plan. So, oh, we gotta do something today. No, we're working on it. But the vision and ideas that we have are gonna last for 25 years. Our update, it's not today. It's get some idea, identify some areas that can work out over the next till 2040. Long after that we're gone. We're trying to do the guiding work, much like the guiding work that went into the, you know, 2030 comp plan and the one before that, and et cetera.
Yeah, one final thing. Tonight's presentation was so valuable because the staff, city staff, showed us for the first time that I've lived in Shakopee all of the sites that are possible. Some of them are hard, and you know that's how you start this.
Well, and they put some scale to it, and I appreciate that. And we didn't have the Legos. We have the markers, but we didn't need them. But I'm very appreciative of at least the way the last couple workshops on it, we got our hands, you know, right on it, touch it, feel it, put it in scale. I do appreciate that, Mike.
I think at the next meeting or the next workshop, staff should bring forward every single property the city owns, and we need to make a decision. Do we keep it? Or market it.
We're not going to have that available by that time. That's a long-term project. We're definitely going to do that. Sam and I have talked about it to a great degree. But, you know, because internally, what essentially I have to do is to go to staff with each piece of property, whether it's parks or public works or even public safety to a degree, and make a determination as to whether or not, you know, it has value added. After we go through that process, then we're going to have some that are, we're going to have some that are maybe, and some that aren't. And so then we'll bring that forward to you, and we'll say, okay, here are our recommendations on these things. That's a long-term project, though. But definitely, you're exactly right, Counselor. We certainly need to do that.
Good. Matt?
Are we to other business yet?
Are we what?
Is there an other business spot on here?
Well, I just wanted to wrap up here on our discussion. So, workshop on the second meeting in March to bring it back together.
We also have a light meeting so far on the is it the third
second.
Now? Second?
Second.
On the second. So it looks like that will be a relatively short meeting at this point. It might not be a bad idea to have some kind of a workshop then. If you continue to reflect on this.
We'll continue this forward. Is that enough for everybody?
Yes. Yeah, the only comment I'd have is I cut off Councilor Mokel, where she was mentioning, do the regulations for R4D make sense? Are there revisions? I guess there's something, if we're having work sessions, there are things that staff could look at in the meantime. So if there's any other input that the council would have on R4D, we've heard Councilor Mokel and Councilor Lehman, if there's any other comments that other folks have.
No, this time.
Well, I just think you put some thought into it. I'm fine with it.
Mm-hmm. Right. And certainly, if you have more comments, you can email Bill Reynolds or staff and try to get their call out the issues that are on your mind. But we've been at this a good hard time. We've seen scale and scope and size. So let's continue down the path here a little bit. Mark, did you have any?
Final comments for me is, showed a lot of properties. Ideally, as a planner, it'd be great to see vacant parcels develop.
Yeah.
Probably over-optimistic that it's gonna happen that fast, just having been here 15 years and seeing that things don't always move as fast as I might like. I also like what Kyle did kind of showed a couple sites, one like the one along Second Avenue that is maybe half a block that could be potential, and the other is a smaller piece. You can see that even though it's not a full acre and 24 units, that's not a bad project. So I don't think we're going to see a lot of huge projects. Just to try to put all the properties together, it's going to be tough to do that in certain situations. I probably see more of these size projects, but I think those are nice projects, and I'm encouraged to see some residential brought to the downtown that could start to bring some synergy with some additional commercial.
Okay,
thanks. To tie in on what Mr. Noble said, I know the other sites that we talked about all around the community, you're looking at much more units in the lot sizes,
right,
that we were talking about. Here it's 24 units in one spot. I mean, again, if even a fourth of those sites are feasible, you're looking at a smaller number of units than, say, 10 acres at 24 units an acre.
Well, that's weird. You know, the last time when we had the bigger map out, we were adding it all up and saying, oh, we're over 1,000 units here.
You're adding,
you know,
by
one,
tens.
One site is 24. You know, four or five of them is a little over 100. So, but, all right, let's move forward here. There isn't a 5AB other business, and we've already approved the agenda. And
all right.
Unless you want to... Did you have something, Matt?
No, I'm good.
Are you sure?
Positive.
All right. Anything else? Okay.
I'll make a motion to adjourn to March 2nd, 2016 at 7 p.m.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilor Whiting, a second by Councilor Luce. Further discussion? 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 All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? Motion carries. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.